one.
He's the one to be praised.
Come on, you remember it. His name is high.
Good evening and welcome to Pentecostal Tabernacles eCampus for another night of Bible study. Let us pray. Lord, we just want to thank you for another night. Father, we invite your presence once again. We ask you one more time, Lord Jesus, to just permeate the atmosphere. We pray, Lord Jesus, that the words of my lips, Lord God, will fall on ground that is fertile and ready to receive your word. I want to thank you, Lord Jesus, and I ask you now to lead, take over, Lord Jesus, and let your will be done tonight. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So this evening we're continuing the Heart Matters series. It is important when doing a series to have context. So if you miss the first two lessons, I want to encourage you to search for Pentab Miami on YouTube or to visit the Pentab app. On Wednesday, June 3rd, Pastor Robert Stewart began the series with the lesson, Guard Your Heart. And last week, I continued with a lesson that asks the question, what is in your heart? Some of the information that I'm using in these lessons is adapted from a concept prepared by Brother Clive and Dr. Michelle Forbes, which was presented at Beyond the Veil in March 2012. The material is being used with their permission. I'm going to begin with a brief recap of last week's lesson. The lesson last week was, what is in your heart? And what is in your heart, we said, is manifested in our actions. It is a communication and scientific truth. You show what is in your heart more by what you do than by what you say. We spoke about the diagnosis. The diagnosis, coming from Jeremiah 17, verse 9, says that the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Then we also spoke about the prescription for the heart condition, and that is found in Proverbs 4, verse 4. Let thine heart retain my words, keep my commandments, and live. We spoke in depth about the fact that because of the heart condition, a heart transplant is needed. In Psalm 51, verse 10, David cried out, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. We concluded that like the physical heart, if the spiritual heart is diseased, it needs a transplant. Where the works of the flesh are present, we need to replace it with the fruit of the Spirit. The steps that are needed after the diagnosis, we followed David's steps when he recognized the condition of his heart. And David's steps were found in Psalm 51, 5 to 13. He acknowledged, he confessed, he accepted the grace of God, he allowed the master surgeon to do a heart transplant, and he went on to witness and proclaim his name. I also shared last week some insight from my farming days. We spoke about seeds. And the phrase that I spoke about was, great oak trees from small acorns grow. Whether good or evil, it all begins with a seed that is planted. So great evil or great good all comes from a seed. And so we have to be careful what seed we put in our heart. The first birth has a corruptible seed because of the entrance of sin. The second birth is an incorruptible seed from the redemptive work of Jesus Christ. So the goal is that you want to make sure that the seed that is planted and nurtured, the seed you fertilize and encourage, is a seed you want to produce a fruit to represent what is in your heart. You want to make sure that the thing that takes root in your heart is coming from a seed of righteousness. Because roots can anchor you or roots can destroy you, depending on the source. So the appropriate answer to the question of what is in your heart should be, out of it flows love for God and love for my neighbor. Out of it are the issues of life. I caution you to keep the heart unclogged, because the heart that God's word cannot change dies. Now this evening, I'm going to be sharing on the topic, the functions of the heart. Now, I'm not a cardiologist by any means. I am not a doctor. I'm not a nurse. But I have a model of a heart here that I'm going to invite you to look at as I go through this section. So the heart consists of four chambers in the heart. And blood flows through these chambers. Blood enters the right atrium, passes through to the right ventricle, and the right ventricle pumps the blood to the lungs, where it becomes oxygenated. The oxygenated blood is brought back to the left atrium, and from the left atrium, it flows into the left ventricle, and the left ventricle pumps the blood to the aorta, which distributes the oxygenated blood to all parts of the body. So, what are some of the functions of the heart that we can see from the illustration in this model? There is blood that needs oxygen, and there is blood that's rich in oxygen. There's blood that needs energy, and blood that gives energy. And proper function is necessary to remove one and supply the other. The flow has to be pumped to the station that can provide the life-giving energy. So we see that the heart is a pump. The heart is one of the most vital and delicate organs in the body. If it does not function properly, all other organs, including the brain, begin to die from lack of oxygen within just a few minutes. Yet the heart is a strong muscular organ. So it's delicate, but it is strong. It needs to be strong to serve as a pump to circulate oxygen-rich blood throughout the body. The pumping action of the heart allows the movement of many substances between organs in the body, including nutrients, waste products, hormones, and other chemical messengers. So why am I giving an anatomy lesson in a Bible study? Which heart am I really talking about? And why am I using the analogy of the physical heart when I'm really referring to the spiritual heart? The reason for that is that there are many references in the Bible to the physical body. And the references to the physical body helps us to understand how the spiritual body, the church, functions. The Word of God tells us that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. God designed our bodies to function efficiently. And observing our physical body helps us to understand how His body, the church, is expected to function. So while we refer to the heart, this is only to help us to understand, as a physical heart is not the subject of this lesson. So what is the spiritual heart? The heart is an unseen part within us that is the seat of emotions and thoughts. The state of health or decay is directly related to the spiritual heart. The spiritual heart is vital to the supply of life to the body. What if the organs that make up the body of Christ could be as unselfish as the physical heart and all the organs and abide in its calling? So how should the spiritual body operate for proper functioning of the whole? Let us look at Ephesians 4, 11 to 13 and verse 16. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. From whom the whole body, fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplies, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. In other words, we each have a job to do. Each of us has unique gifts. Do what God gave you to do. Or in other words, stay in your lane. Every organ in the spiritual body is important, and each should function in its assigned role. When we learn about the physical body, it teaches us this truth. Every organ in the body is vital. Let me repeat that. Every organ in the physical body, no matter how insignificant we think it is, it's vital. And every organ in the spiritual body is also vital. God designed it so we all fit together perfectly to form the body. If life is to be maintained, the physical heart never stops beating. The physical heart is always pumping blood. The heart beats 80,000 to 100,000 times a day. Anything that affects the heart affects the function of the heart. The heart regulates the flow through the body. And if the heart stops functioning, the body stops. We can determine the state of the heart by the response of the body. And we can also predict what will happen to the body by the condition of the heart. If spiritual health and spiritual life is to be maintained, the spiritual heart has to keep beating. It has to remain connected to Jesus, the life-giving source. Our spiritual heart should never stop working. So, earlier when we looked at this heart model, we found out that blood that needs to go to the lung to get oxygen comes in on the right side. And once it has received the oxygen, it comes in on the left side and is then pumped to the rest of the body. So in the same organ, we're seeing that there's pure and impure passing through, but it's maintaining its distinction by following a predetermined order. Now in the spiritual heart, every thought and imagination passes through our heart, our mind, whether it is good or evil. So the mind becomes a filter. And everything that comes into our mind, we should allow it to be filtered through the word of God for cleansing. Only then should we allow anything to pass to the rest of the body. So we ought not to allow impure thoughts to dictate our speech and actions. We also need to maintain God's predetermined order. Jesus Christ is the head of the church. There is order in the church. There should be order in our lives, in how we conduct ourselves, in how we separate from the world, even though we are in the world. If there was no order in the heart, impure and pure blood would be mixed together. So we have to understand that even though everything comes into our mind, we have to make sure we keep that distinction and filter it through the word. So what is in the heart affects our outlook on life. The heart is a thermostat to regulate relationships. Now, the thermometer only records what the temperature is. It does not determine, it does not dictate. But as Christians, we should function as thermostats. We ought to be setting the tone. Wherever we enter, light enters. Wherever we step becomes holy ground. And the condition of our interpersonal relationships are dictated by the condition of our heart. Let me give you an example from Proverbs 17:22. What are some of the things that are in our heart? In Proverbs 17:22, so we see in our heart there is love, there is obedience, there is repentance, forgiveness, being unselfish, caring, and a merry heart. Proverbs 17:22 says, a merry heart doeth good like a medicine, but a broken spirit drieth the bones. So merry heart, merry spirit equals merry and happy relationships. Broken spirit equals broken, sad relationships. This is another reminder to us that we need to care about each other. We need to care about our spiritual needs, our physical needs, and also our emotional needs. Because hurting people hurt people. We need to heal wounds. We need to be a part of the solution and not the problem. Everything that comes from the heart works together to determine our actions. The spiritual heart functions as a source of love. It determines character and it controls speech. Now, if we begin with love for God, it should be easier to love each other. If we put love in, we will pump love out. Deuteronomy 6:5 says, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart and with all thy soul and with all thy might. This is a source of love that should be in the heart. If we begin with the love for God, it will influence how we treat everybody else. The heart also determines character. Proverbs 23:7. For as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. Eat and drink, saith he to thee, but his heart is not with thee. The heart controls speech. Luke 6:45. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is good. And an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is evil. For of the abundance of the heart, his mouth speaketh. So, like the physical heart, the spiritual heart is a pump. Something is always flowing from it. We mentioned this in last week's lesson as an important reason to do a heart checkup. Life flows from our heart. The Bible refers to it as the issues of life. Another translation refers to it as the source of life. We guard our spiritual heart, knowing that while it is strong enough to resist the devil and to contend for the faith, it is also delicate and we need to protect what goes in. Last week we spoke about seeds and their potential to grow, take root, and destroy. So we are diligent about what we allow into our minds. We are admonished to have the mind of Christ. Philippians 2, 1 to 5 reads, "If there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies, fulfill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." Let me pause a little right there to say, this is not a very easy thing for us to do. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. We are by nature very selfish, and so it's very difficult for us to prefer one another, to accede to somebody else. We are very much into the me, my mentality. But if we are to be obedient to Philippians 2, 1 to 5, we are told to think about others. Think less of ourselves and think more of others. So we are told in verse 5 to let this mind be in us, which was also in Christ Jesus. So what was the mind? What is the mind of Christ that we need to have? He was one with God, so there was unity displayed. In his mind, there was humility, love. He was unselfish. He stepped down from his glory in order to serve us. He was purpose-driven. He had a servant's heart, and he was obedient. These are the attributes that we are told to have in our mind if we're going to have the mind of Christ. Many times we blame others for aborted purpose, plans that are not fulfilled, dreams not realized, when some of this may really be a result of our own heart condition. If we align ourselves and our heart to what was evident in the heart of Christ, we will fulfill our purpose just as he did. So, what is the characteristic of the heart that will be able to carry out its functions? Our hearts need to be tender. Tender to the word of God and tender to each other. You see, a tender heart can be affected, can be changed. It's dynamic. It's not static. A tender heart will respond to God's commands. It will be obedient. A tender heart will respond to the needs of man. So we will be sensitive and caring if we have a tender heart. A tender heart will respond to 1 John 1, verse 9, which reads, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. It begins with confession. I know it's an old-fashioned thing, but it still works. If we confess our sins, he's faithful. And that establishes the vertical relationship when we confess. A tender heart will respond to John 13, verses 34 to 35. A new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another, as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one to another. And that establishes the horizontal relationship, the relationship that we have with each other. So my heart condition affects me. It determines my diagnosis. My heart condition affects others. It determines how fragile and dependent I become. My heart condition affects the flow, it affects the energy supply. It determines whether or not I fulfill or abort purpose. And my heart condition affects my prognosis. It determines life or death. Now, God is not pleased when our lips and our heart are not in harmony. Listen to what he says in Matthew 15, verses 8 to 9. This people draweth nigh unto me with their mouth, and honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. But in vain they do worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. So what we're hearing here is that sometimes the lip service that we're giving to God is not being received. Because we're drawing nigh with our lips, but our heart is not right. And because our heart is not right, our actions are not going to be right. So when it comes to how we treat each other, how we demonstrate what is in our heart, there is an expectation for us to live up to. It is actually a command. And I know I've said it before, but I'm going to repeat. John 13, verses 34 to 35. A new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one to another. Now the biblical instructions are clear. Romans 12:10, and I'm reading from the Amplified Version. It says, let your love be sincere, a real thing. In other words, don't fake it. Hate what is evil. Loathe all ungodliness. Turn in horror from wickedness, but hold fast to that which is good. Love one another with brotherly affection, as members of one family, giving precedence and showing honor to one another. This kind of love is not only talk, it manifests in actions. What is in the heart needs to reflect on the outside. How will people know that we are the disciples of Jesus if there's no manifestation of our love? Worse, what if what is displayed does not even reflect Christ? How will people know? You know, if you think about the season that we're in, we're used to displaying love with a handshake and a hug. We're not able to do that now because we are physically distancing. But there are many other ways that we ought to be able to demonstrate our love so that the world can see that we are children of God. Is it any wonder that in Luke 6:46 there is this rebuke? Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not practice what I tell you? I interpret from this that if we're not being obedient to God, we really don't have any right to refer to him as Father or Lord. Because if we're not being obedient to him, if we're not doing what he tells us, the question he's asking is, why are you calling me Lord when you're not doing what I tell you? So our heart, our lips, and our actions need to get on the same page. They need to be in alignment. We make choices for our lives and in our relationships based on a self-centered approach rather than a Christ-centered perspective. When every decision that we make is viewed through the lens of being a child of God, only then will our activities begin to reflect our identity. Our identity demands that we conduct ourselves in a particular manner. If our action becomes inconsistent with our identity, then our identity becomes questionable. If God says we are to love and we don't love, then we will be judged by the world and we will be judged by the word. If our identity is questionable, then the God we identify with will be questionable in the minds of those we are trying to reach. We must fix the vertical relationship, that's the relationship with God. And it will affect the horizontal relationship, the relationship we have with each other. I want to pause just a little to say that we cannot claim that we love God and not love each other. We cannot claim that we love God and not love each other. We are God's children. And if we love God and that love is in our heart, that love will be pumped out of the heart. So if we're not loving each other, but you know, we have a great relationship and a special relationship with God, we need to check ourselves. We need to go back to the surgeon's office. In closing, I want to quote Bishop Lamont Harrington. His words were, God is magnified by the church on earth and exalted by the church in heaven. But the last place for him to be exalted is in the human heart. Martin Luther King spoke on love. He said, love is the only force capable of transforming an enemy into a friend. Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. He said, we must develop and maintain the capacity to forgive. He who is devoid of the power to forgive is devoid of the power to love. There is some good in the worst of us and some evil in the best of us. When we discover this, we are less prone to hate our enemies. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for another time spent in your word. And Lord, I just pray that the few seeds that were planted tonight, Lord, will take root. I ask you, Lord Jesus, to speak to each and every one of us. I want to thank you, Lord, for speaking to me, for touching me, for turning the searchlights inward so that I examine myself. And I pray, Lord Jesus, that we will all do the same. God, we want to be like you. We want to love. And in this time, Lord Jesus, we ask you to give us that heart, heart to forgive, and the heart to love, and the desire to be a part of the solution and not a part of the problem. We give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for joining us tonight for another Bible study. We invite you to reach out to us on our social media platforms if you have any prayer requests. For our members, be reminded that there will be prayer in the sanctuary this Friday, June 19, at 7 p.m. Please join us on Sunday at 11:15 a.m. in our e-campus for morning worship as we honor our fathers. To conclude the Heart Matters study next week, Wednesday, I will have a guest and we will have a discussion on the practical applications of Heart Matters to our interpersonal relationships. So see you next week. Have a blessed evening, and we look forward to you joining us for the upcoming services. May God richly bless you.
Come on, he's the one.
He's the one to be praised.
Come on, you remember it. His name is higher.
His name is higher
than any other name.